Hello, I am Thibaut Trude, CTO at VitaDX. Thanks for having me today. In this talk, we'll see how to annotate your in situ slides to improve bladder cancer detection. It won't be a very technical talk. It is more a testimony and a feedback about the usage of the Kili platform. So at VitaDX, we are a small startup of 20 employees, and we use the Kili platform for the R&D of our VisiSeed software, which is dedicated to bladder cancer detection. First of all, a little background. Why are we interested in bladder cancer? Simply because it is a fairly common cancer. It is the fifth cancer in France and the first one in terms of recurrence. And yet, the diagnostic solution used are either painful for the patient or not very effective. Painful, first of all, with endoscopy. Endoscopy consists in passing a camera through the patient's urethra to observe his bladder. So as you can imagine, it is an invasive and painful act. The moderately effective solution is cytology, but it has the great advantage of being very easy to implement. It consists in taking a simple urine sample and observing it under the microscope. With VisioSeed, our goal is to improve urine cytology. So let's take a closer look at this cytology slide. So why is urine cytology so hard? Simply because the pathologist is alone with his microscope in front of a slide containing about 30,000 cells. So it will be complicated for him to look at all these cells and to detect sometimes weak signals of cancer to say whether or not we are in the presence of bladder cancer. So much so that for early cancers, urine cytology has only 25% of sensitivity. To improve urine cytology, we are going to switch to digital cytology. We will digitize this microscope slide with a scanner, and we will obtain a huge image of several billion pixels. This will allow us to use algorithms to detect and classify all the cells in the slide, and then compute parameters and criteria of interest on each of these objects. We'll thus obtain a huge amount of information to perform our diagnosis. To develop VisioSeed, we had access to about 1,000 urine cytologies like this one within the framework of a clinical trial. We also had access to the cancer, not cancer ground truth, which is given by the patient's follow-up and the result of reliable tests like endoscopy. So, what are the challenges in terms of annotation when developing such a solution? The first challenge is the regulatory constraint. In fact, we are developing a medical software and we aim to obtain the CE marking. And this will push us to make an explainable analysis. Explainability means that we are not going to make an analysis which is a big black box model. We are going to produce instead an analysis which is a succession of logical steps as the pathologist would have done. For example, detect the cellular objects, find the urothelial cells, segment the nuclei and the cytoplasm, compute atypical criteria, etc., etc. So we'll have one or more machine learning models for each step of the analysis. And for each model, we'll need a dataset for the training, but also a dataset for the performance test, because the CE marking requires us to measure the performance of each step of the analysis. So as we can see, making an explainable analysis requires managing and annotating a lot of datasets. The second constraint is medical data. In the domain of classical images, the objects are rather simple and the classes are relatively well separated. So anyone can annotate these images. In the domain of medical images, however, the objects are rather complex and the classes rather badly separated. So why are they poorly separated? Well, because they are biological objects, which are in a way in continuous transformation. So between the very healthy objects on the left and the very sick objects on the right, we'll find a vast amount of intermediate stages in our slides. And these objects will be difficult to classify even by experts. So how do experts annotate these difficult objects? They will try to read a certain number of atypical criteria, notably on the texture and the color of the nucleus. This means that each expert will have his own assessment, and we will end up with classification boundaries that are expert-dependent. So as we can see, the medical field involves complex data and annotation with very high variance. However, if we want to develop expert model, we will need expert annotation and quality annotation. So let's look at the ingredients for successful models. The first ingredient is organization. So we at VitaDX have created a team dedicated to the question of annotations. It is a multidisciplinary team with a data project manager who leads the project, medical experts who are cytotechnicians and biologists who bring medical expertise and knowledge of urine cytology, and R&D engineers who are also brought into the loop and will bring their knowledge of algorithms and data exploitation. The second ingredient is document standardization. For each annotation project, the team writes annotation guidelines that will harmonize the way annotations are made among experts. These guidelines describe the different classes, how they are annotated, how edge cases are annotated, what the decision criteria are, etc., etc. In these guidelines, we also detail a certain number of annotation scenarios. Here is one of many. In our slides, we sometimes have objects that are a bit blurred, and everyone does as they please to annotate the edge. So in this case, the R&D team asks to standardize the edge annotation on the blurred outer edge in order to have an homogeneous dataset. The third key point is to have continuous access to quality metrics. So with the Keeley platform, we have access to honeypots to measure the quality of annotators and to consensus to measure the quality of annotation. So what is the honeypot? It is simply a series of reference images for which we know the truth very well. The annotator will annotate them, and if they make a mistake, we'll be able to detect it and, for example, review the guidelines with them. Consensus is having the images annotated by several annotators, so we have access to several labels per image, and we can assess for each image the concordance or discordance of labels. So now that we have seen the ingredients, let's see the recipe. We have set up a very simple organization that allows us to quickly find problems in the project framework to iterate and improve it. So it's done with a pre-project, which is very important. These are steps 1, 2, and 3 in this flowchart. We start with the definition. We write our guidelines for the current project. We explain the annotation of the classes, the edge cases, etc., etc. And we immediately test these annotation guidelines by going into dry run. This is to say we inject images onto the platform and we test our guidelines by annotating our images. In fact, while testing them, we realize that there are problems in our guidelines. For example, object classes that we hadn't seen in the first place, edge cases that are poorly explained or misunderstood, annotation scenario that we hadn't anticipated, etc., etc. So we'll go back to definition, we'll rewrite our guidelines to improve them, and we'll go back to dry run and retest them. We will repeat this cycle 2 or 3 times. It can take up to 2 weeks, but the pre-project is a step that we have standardized in all our projects because it is key to the success of the rest of the annotation project. Once we have robust guidelines, we enter the annotation phase. Here, we will annotate by batch of images to pace the project, and the data project manager will be able to review the annotated images in real time. And he will be able to detect, for example, those that have a bad consensus and ask for a re-annotation. So this will allow us to quickly obtain a first quality dataset that will be transferred to the R&D team. The R&D team will be able to develop their models and compute performance metrics. And as a last step, we can review the performance metrics and visualize the prediction of the models with the medical team. If it is not satisfactory, it is not a big deal we will go back to annotation and re-annotate new batch of images. If the performance is satisfactory, we can move to other R&D projects and other models. So that's the basic framework. And the idea is to mix this framework with a few tricks to optimize the use and production of annotation. The first of these tricks is R mining, which consists in orienting the production of new annotations and therefore also the training of models on useful images. What are useful images? These are the images for which the model at this stage is not good. To find these useful images, we will simply take our model and infer it on images that it has never seen. And with the platform, we will review the images and the prediction of the model and annotate the error cases. These error cases will be re-injected into the trained dataset, and we will retrain our model to improve it. So, a small concrete example, on a rather complicated task of cell cluster segmentation, with only 10% more images in the trained dataset, we were able to boost the sensitivity by 5% and the specificity by 15%. So R mining allows us to improve performance faster. A second trick that uses the output of the models, but this time to boost the production of the annotators, is to inject the prediction of the model into the platform to have pre-annotations. For example, on a complex task of cell cluster segmentation, we can see that it is much faster for the annotator to validate or correct the proposed annotation than to have it to draw it from scratch. So here again, some metrics. On this cluster segmentation task, we were able to divide by 6 the annotation time by combining models and annotators. Last trick is to leverage self-supervised learning technique. Just because we have a process in place to produce quality annotation does not mean that we only use annotation. For most of our model, we pre-train our CNN on lots of unlabeled images with contrastive learning technique to best adapt the weights of our model to our specific images. Then the model is trained as regards to the final classification of segmentation task with a high quality label dataset. We end up with better performance as compared to a training done only on annotated images. Our typical model is trained on about 1 million labeled images and between 20 and 30,000 carefully annotated images. So what result do we get when we implement this organization and use this kind of tools? First of all, looking at the local level analysis, for which we have to measure performance metrics for CU marking, we have obtained quite satisfactory performance, which will allow us to give credibility to our technical file for obtaining the CE marking. But of course, what we are interested in is the diagnostic performance. It is to say, how well VisiCeat detects bladder cancer. So the device was sent to a clinical trial involving 300 patients, and an independent organization computed the performance of VisiCeat and compared it with the performance of urine cytology. We were able to show a strong gain in sensitivity, both on the high grades and the low grades concern, and we validated this clinical trial. So this is an important milestone for Vitalix and for VisiCeat, which will be released in a few weeks. But of course, we are not going to stop there. We are doing software and machine learning. So the idea is to improve the performance of the analysis every year by training our models on more data and more annotations. In conclusion, we can say that in the medical field, the quality of the data and the annotation is really key to the success of the model. So there is a real interest in iterating on data rather than models. We must pay attention to the consistency of the data, especially by carefully framing the annotation project and writing the annotation guidelines. We must try to explore all the data scenario and all the annotation scenario. So that's why we iterate on the guidelines and we do R mining to extend the scope of the models. And to set up all this, it's easier to work with a platform like Keely, which offers a whole range of tools to set it up quickly. Thanks for hearing me. If you have any question or remarks, feel free to send me an email. Bye.